Welcome to Harmony Hill. We are so glad you are spending Sunday morning with us. Before worship begins, please silence your mobile devices. VBS will be June 24th through 28th at Harmony Hill. VBS is for children who have completed kindergarten through fifth grade. At Roar VBS, kids will discover that God is good even when life gets wild. VBS is free of charge. Invite your friends and register online at thehill.life. We are forming a construction advisory team to assist in the construction of the new children's building. If you have construction experience and would like to join the team, please send an email to building@harmony-hill.org or turn in a connection card to the information counter. Summer Reading Club is a great way for children and adults to spend the summer reading books and learning scripture. Sign up today in the library. This month, every dollar in the missions box during the month of June goes to support our missionaries serving in the Horn of Africa. For more information, visit the missions room this morning. For more things happening on the Hill, please check your weekly bulletin and watch the announcements at the end of worship today. Welcome to Worship on the Hill.
Could you play the announcements over again? I'm tuning my guitar. No, I'm kidding. How y'all doing? Well, good. So make sure you clear your throats. La, 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 la. Get ready, because we're fixing to worship, fixing to sing, fixing to listen to the word this morning, fixing to testify, do all the things that have to do with church. So y'all stand with me. Y'all ready? Yeah. I am saved. Hallelujah. I am forgiven. Hallelujah. He has a purpose for my life. Hallelujah. And one day he's coming back to take us home. Yeah. I'm sorry, I've been at camp all week. They are really loud at camp, all right, the kids. We're going to have them in here one day, and it's amazing. If this is your first time at Harmony Hill Baptist Church, we'd like to just take this time to welcome you here, and hopefully you'll get the chance to meet some people. But right now, I'd like for you to look in the back of the seat that's in front of you, and there should be a pouch there and a connection card and a pen. At some point during the service, we'd like you to fill that out, then place it in offering bags when you're exiting this room. When you get into the next long room, which is called our lobby, there'll be a information desk out there. If you have any questions, this is for everybody, if you have any questions about the service, about the sermon, about songs that were played, or just what's going on the Hill during the week, just ask them, and if they know the answer, they'll tell you. If they don't, then they'll figure out a way to get it to you. Let's just worship him. We're going to teach you a new song. There's a possibility you could know it if you've listened to a radio somewhere. But here we go. We'll learn it and sing it.
nothing shall be impossible.
Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God. Sing nothing. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
Come on, make some noise.
So this is Ephesians 6, and it says, a final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all the strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in heavenly places. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, you will still be standing firm. Stand your ground. Put on the belt of truth and the body armor of God's righteousness. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. In addition to all of these, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. Put on salvation as your helmet and take the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times and on every occasion. Stay alert and be persistent in your prayers for all believers everywhere. The cross is my beginning, the line drawn in the sand, the end of all my striving. Now I am born again. There Jesus was forsaken, so I will never be. His grace is my salvation, the gift of God, the work of Calvary. It is done, it is finished.
His mercy is complete. His love is not a question. The Son of God has spoken over.
Holy name, Jesus, you will reign forever.
more. The victory is yours. Offer this sacrifice for every sin. Our Savior God, the Lord of life, can't be contained. Our God.
Is his. That's so good, isn't it? We don't have to do it. He paid the price for our sins. Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. We see. Father God, thank you for taking on our sin. Father, but also thank you for defeating all the wars that are happening around, Lord God, that are fighting for to turn us, which can't be done because the victory is yours, but still the war's raging to keep us from looking to you, from hearing your word. Father, thank you that we do not stand alone. That through the salvation that we have experienced from you, that we have a fighter victorious over death, over the power of darkness. So this morning we stand, Lord, in your presence, waiting to hear your word spoken. Father, I ask for your favor over Pastor John as he stands before over here, oh, before us, as you've anointed him to preach your word. Let us hear what you have said, what you will say, and then let's live by it. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to The Hill. It's good to have you. If you will open God's Word this morning, we're going to be looking at the book of Ephesians, chapter 6 in God's New Testament, chapter 6, verse 1 through 4. And I'll invite your attention there. Look inside your Sunday bulletin for the Life Point outline. If you're new here, that will help you get through God's Word this morning. As we're getting ready, at the end of the service this morning, we're going to have a baptism. Philip Johnson is going to be baptizing Rivers Freeman, and we're looking forward to that. Rivers came to know the Lord and made a profession of faith in Christ and turned his life over to the Lord this past Easter. And in discussion with him about his baptism, he asked about having Philip Johnson to baptize him. Philip had a part in Rivers' life in working in children's ministry several years ago. And even though Rivers came to faith in Christ just this last Easter, Philip was the one who really made an impression in his life and had an impact in him. And so Philip's going to be baptizing him in just a few moments. So we're looking forward to that. And I just want to say, if you're wondering about a place for you to serve this morning, children's ministry is a great place to start and to consider having an impact in the lives of kids. And you're going to see the testimony of that. Even though Philip wasn't the one who led him to faith in Christ, he goes back to Philip as being someone who impacted him for the Lord. And so I want to encourage you to be there. Also, Beth Johnson, she and Philip have been here like almost forever, as coming in as kids and then getting married and having raising family here and everything. And that, excuse me, they were one of our first families to leave and move and go somewhere to serve the Lord. And so they're in Waxahachie serving the Lord with Remedy Church there. And Beth is, Philip has gone up there. He got a new job. Beth is working there in the church and children's ministry. And so we're going to be having this evening at 5:30 at the Harmony House, we're going to be having a time for Beth to share her ministry, what God is doing. Beth, is the pastor going to be here? Is that still? Okay. And so you get a chance to meet the pastor. He's going to talk about Beth's impact in their church. Also give us an opportunity personally, if you'd like to help come alongside Beth and support her in this mission project and emphasis in her life, you'll have the opportunity to make a commitment to do that. So I encourage you, if you want to be a part of that, Catherine and I will be there. Please come and be considering that, because we're just seeing what God is doing. This is the first of our families that God is relocating for the cause of sharing the gospel and helping churches to grow. So it's an exciting time. All right, we're in a series during the summer. We're titling it Wisdom for Our Days. And what I want to do starting this morning, I'm going to take two, maybe three Sundays, and I want us to focus really on the family. And so if you notice, if you got your Life Point outline out, we're going to be talking about God's plan for children. And I could say God's plan for parents and children, but I just put children. And so this is really part one. And I want us to look, we're beginning at Ephesians chapter 6. And so we're just going to get God's take on the family. We're going to get God's take on marriage and all those kinds of things. And so children, God says, obey your parents in the Lord, because this is right. This is the right thing to do. that you honor your parents, you obey your parents. And then he says, honor your father and your mother, which is the first commandment with a promise. And the promise was so that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. So here's the deal. God says, if a child, if you obey, if you honor your parents, you seek to live in a life of obedience under them while you're at home, God says there are two things that come from this. Number one, the blessing of life will be on you. And number two, you may not live as long as you want to live, but you'll live as long as God intended for you to live originally. I don't know how long I'm going to be here on this earth. Neither do you. But Scripture says our days were already numbered when we drew our first breath. And so God says when you honor mom and dad, that is an insurance policy on you living as long as God intended for you to live on this earth. So God has some protections put in there. And then he says, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. All right, so what's our takeaway from this? Okay, so first of all, what God is simply saying to us is this. God designed society. He designed the human race to exist in the context of families. Families. In Genesis chapter 1, God told Adam and Eve, he said, be fruitful and what? Multiply. In other words, I want you to make many Adamses and little Eves. I want you to replicate yourself again and again. After the flood, when God destroyed all of humanity except for eight souls, Noah, his wife, his three boys, and their wives, God comes to them and he says to them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. So here's the insight I want you to notice in your life point outline. Families are God's chosen instrument to pass truth and righteousness, or how to live rightly in this world, from one generation to the next. Now, why is that important, ladies and gentlemen? All right, here. It is important because we have a generation of young people, even Christian young people, who fear having children. And of course, you get this from the world. You know, the world comes in and tells us, you know, we're overpopulating the planet. We're going to destroy this planet. You even have women. You've got a movement now about women are, I forget what the name of it is, but anyway, women are putting off having kids. We're not going to have kids until this changes, until you stop destroying the earth. Now, don't you understand something, ladies and gentlemen? God's word puts a lot of us at ease if we'll listen to it. God says over in the book of Revelation, he said, the earth is going to be destroyed. You will not be the ones doing it. He said, I will destroy the heavens and the earth. When Jesus Christ comes back, the earth is going to be here. It's going to be here. You and I are not going to destroy the planet. We get all upset and get ourselves all in a wad about hairspray. Seriously? Hairspray? It's not going to destroy the planet. Listen, you want to know God's take on our earth? God's take on our earth is drill for oil. Shoot a deer. Walk on the grass. Why? You're not going to destroy the planet. God says, I made this planet to last. I made this planet to be here. Those that are shouting this again and again and again are people who are not listening to him. And all I'm wanting to say is there are Christian people who fear having children. And at the same time, American culture that you and I are immersed in is permitting the destruction of the family. I think perhaps the only taboo in American culture today is biblical morality. That's really the only taboo. Everything else is kind of, you know, open game. And so what we have today is we have fornication and we have adultery abounding at a pandemic level. Now, all I want to do is just open up biblical morality. I want to open up biblical, what the biblical family looks like, okay? So I'm just talking to you. I'm not talking at you. I want you to get my heart on this. So when we talk about fornication, we talk about adultery. I want to make sure everybody understands what we're talking about. Fornication, biblically, is when a man and a woman who are not married at all are having sex with each other outside of God's plan. That's not God's plan. God said that is a sin, and it will cause you to lose my blessing on your life. It will bring a adverse reward. So fornication is an unmarried man having a physical sexual relationship with an unmarried woman. Adultery is when a married man is having sex with a woman who is not his wife, or a married woman with a man who is not her husband. That is adultery. And it is sin in the eyes of God. And what God simply says is, when you do that, I will begin to lift my hand of blessing off of you. And what that means is, when you begin to live that lifestyle, life begins to have and produce a plethora of issues and problems. That's why we see the world in the confusion and the hurt that it is in today. And then we have abortion on demand. Abortion on demand in America, do you know what it does? It permits women who are really the last line of defense against immorality. Women now today in America are permitting themselves, because of abortion, to be licentious as much as men, to be promiscuous with not one man, but multiple men. And then in our country, if the inconvenience of a pregnancy happens, no problem, we have abortion. And we have abortion on demand. In other words, you want it, you can have it. And when people marry, if they do marry, and they don't like the way it is, there's always the convenience of divorce, and they can break that, and then they can go on to another relationship. Pornography is rampant in our country. And oddly enough, it's protected under free speech. And so we allow this perversity and the filth of it to continue in our land. And so here's the truth I want you to see in the outline. American culture embraces and escalates itself moral corruption. And so America, according to Romans 1, is under divine judgment. People talk all the time, is God judging America? Yes. He's also judging many other nations in the world. God is doing that. Let me show you what I'm talking about. In Romans chapter 1, verses 21 through 23, there is, first of all, God says, here's where it starts. It starts with idolatry. Idolatry is the first sin of a society, and that's when a people forsakes the worship of God and they begin to worship themselves. And what is the sign that a people is worshiping themselves, according to what God says? God says it's when they forsake the worship of God and they begin to chase after two things, because that is self, that marks self-worship. What are the two things that mark self-worship? A proclivity and a chasing after pleasure and chasing after wealth. Those two things. We begin to chase wealth and we begin to chase pleasure above everything else. And that means that the worship of God is no longer convenient. Why? Because there are things that I want to do. God says once every 7 days, I want you to present yourself before me and I want you to remember that I'm God and that you're not. Once every 7 days, I want you to present yourself before me and say, God, all of the blessing of my life comes from you. I'm not the one who generates it. You're the one who puts a blessing on my life. You're the one who provides for me. You're the one who protects me. You're the one who watches over me. And so once every 7 days, we come before God in order to honor him and to seek him and to bless his name. But when I begin to worship myself, I don't have time for that. Why? Because I want to please myself. Pleasing myself is the most important thing. And so I want to go here, I want to go there, I want to spend my money on this, I want to spend my money on that. Why? Because the most important thing for me is pleasure. I want to please myself. That's the first great sin that leads us down a road away from the Lord. And that leads to the next judgment of God. God then begins to take his blessing off of people. And then we find a sexual revolution. That's in Romans 1, verse 24. Romans 1:24 is when God moves his hand off of people and you see people beginning to chase after sex above everything else. We saw that as far back as the 1960s in America. And you would see on television, you would see kids out in the fields. They would have rock bands and there would be marijuana and all this and everything. And they would have blankets on the ground and there would be young kids, young college kids. Of course, they're not married. And they're there and guys are with girls and they're half clothed and they're walling around with each other. And of course, all manner of sex and promiscuity happens. And that is because God is lifting his hand of restraint. It used to be people were afraid to live that kind of life. Why? Because they had the fear of God. But now they no longer do that. They've lost touch with him. And so sexual liberation comes, and sex is nothing more than a biological event. There's nothing holy about it. We're animals anyway, and so you just satisfy that need. Sexual revolution, that is the judgment of God. And then, verse 26 and 27, there comes the homosexual judgment. Homosexuality begins to spread. That's what God says in Romans 1, verse 26 and 27. Men begin to burn toward other men. Women begin to burn toward other women and do that which is unseemly. And so that's a judgment of the Lord. And so we're all about that in America today. And then after that comes verse 28 through 32, and that is God turns us over to a reprobate mind. In other words, we simply can't think straight. Up is down, down is up, right is wrong, white is black, and black is white. And so we call things that used to be so clear, now we're no longer sure. Nothing is certain anymore. You know why that is? That's a judgment of God. It's a reprobate mind. And that is one of the last steps before a people lose everything. And so here's the insight I want you to see in your outline. The greatest source of corrupt minds is in the universities who shape and educate the next generation of Americans. And maybe you wondered, I just want to share with you. I know when we had Senior Sunday, if you were here, you probably thought, Pastor, you're speaking a pretty tough message here to our seniors. I want to tell you why. It's because I want to speak in the hearts of these young men and women that I care about, that are members of our family, that we have an opportunity to influence. And I want moms and dads, I want you, I want myself, I want my son and my daughter, I want us daughter-in-laws, I want them thinking about this thing, that if we do not pay attention, we will take our money that God has blessed us with and we will use it to pay university professors who don't love God to destroy the faith of our children. We have lost the universities across our country. And I'm not saying this is not every professor. Lord knows there are some godly people still in education. I am grateful for that. But there is a plethora of PhDs and other professors who have no heart for God, and they will turn your child against the things of Christ. And they do it. And that's because we've lost the universities. And what I'm simply saying is the path that has led us to where we are today, the path that has led us to where we are in the universities in America today leads back to the home. We are where we are today because of the homes of the last generation. That's why this is so important. And so I want to just speak to you, not at you. And so I want you to know I'm preaching this to myself. I'm seeing and saying, just God, what do you want to say to us? And we're going to take it from this word. And I want you to hear what God has to say about children and about the family and about parents. All right, number one, this is in your life point outline. Number one, children are a blessing of God. Children are a blessing. Children, ladies and gentlemen, are not a problem. Children are not a trial. Children are a blessing of God. That's what the Bible says. God told Adam and Eve, he said, be fruitful and what? Multiply. Fill the earth with children. Adam lived over 900 years. He had a lot of time to reproduce and bring kids into the world. When we get down to Genesis chapter 29, there's a guy named Jacob. And really, I have to say, through no fault of his own, he wound up being married to two women who were sisters. That is a concoction for trouble, is it not? Marrying sisters. And so his first wife was Leah. She was the oldest of the two. She was a baby-producing machine. And before they knew it, she gave him five boys. Man, she was great as a child-bearing woman. And she rejoiced in that. But then there was Rachel, whom Jacob really loved. And the Bible says she was barren. And Rachel just couldn't hardly stand it. So in Genesis 30, it says, when Rachel saw that she bore Jacob no kids, she became jealous of her sister. Surprise there. And she said to Jacob, give me children or else I die. So there's this thing about the women wanted to have children. That's the message that God is getting across in the Word. Verse 23, Genesis 30. She conceived, God blessed her. She conceived, bore a son, and she said, God has taken away my reproach. And she named him Joseph, saying, may the Lord give me another son. So it's like for her, one child wasn't enough. And so biblically, what I want you to understand, biblically, a woman's desire is to have children, plural. Why? Because children are a blessing of God. Listen to Psalm 127, verse 3. Behold, the children are a gift from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be ashamed when they speak with their enemies in the gate. So here's the truth. Biblically, it was a shame to not have children. That's what I want you to take away with that. God is simply saying, children are a blessing. Though we know for some, God's plan is adoption. It is not a reproach that a man and a woman cannot produce a child. That simply means God's got another plan. And there are some kids in this world that need a home. Would you agree with that? And so one of God's plans is adoption. And maybe that's God's plan for you. That is not a curse. That's just a different plan. All right, so number one, children are a blessing. Number two, parenting is a blessing. Three times in the book of Proverbs, we're told a son makes a father's heart glad. Now, maybe you say, well, my son is not making my heart glad right now. Well, there's an answer for that. Proverbs 29:17, correct him and he will give you rest. Yes, he will give delight to your soul. So what God is simply saying is, he said, I want you to understand, here's my word on it. Parenting is a blessing. It's not a curse. It's my plan for a man and a woman to get married. And on average, my plan is that they reproduce and multiply. And that doesn't mean they just replace themselves. They multiply. Number three, parenting success is on parents, not children. Proverbs 22:6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. Now, I want you to understand what God is saying. He's saying that children, on the whole, testify to their parenting, how they were parented. Now, I want you to understand, Proverbs 22:6 is an axiom, all right? It is a truism of Scripture. In other words, this is not a law. It's not like if you do this, this is the way it's always going to happen. He's simply saying, on the whole, you train a child in the way he or she should go, and when they're old, they will not depart from it. What it simply means is that dedicated, consistent, biblical parenting, while it is not a guarantee that your son or daughter is going to chase after the Lord, it's not a guarantee they're going to go to heaven when they die. It is not that guarantee. But as a rule, children become what you raise them to become. There is the self-will of a child. And what God is simply saying is the best opportunity every child you have will come to faith in Christ rests on you parenting them the way God has designed for you to do it. Parenting is important for a child. So the insight in your outline, children become what parents lead them and allow them to become. Nothing I do, nothing you do guarantees they'll be saved. But God says our children will be on the whole products of our parenting. So my parenting is measured by how I do my job. It's measured by me. It's not my son. It's not my boys. My parenting is judged by how I do it. How did my kids turn out? That's the judgment on whole of my parenting. Children become whatever the parent shapes them to be. Let me give you chapter and verse on that. Luke chapter 6, verse 40. When a man is fully trained, He will be like his teacher. And so what God is saying is, children, on the whole, take the shape you and I provide for them in our parenting. That's the reason why I have said from this pulpit time and time again, parenting is nonstop. You don't take coffee breaks in parenting. You don't take vacations from parenting. So the truth in your outline, parenting cannot be part-time. It's got to be what you focus on. That's the reason why God is seeking to give us wisdom as his kids. We cannot parent the way the world does. What do I mean by that? Listen, I understand when Catherine and I were started out having children, one of the things we talked about was that we're going to have a decision to make. You know, Catherine had a degree. She could get a job outside the home. But even as far back as 1975, we made a conscious decision that it was going to be all right if everybody else our age that we graduated school with, if they got ahead of us financially. It was going to be okay. I mean, it's not like this generation is the first one to think about both people working, right? And so we made a conscious decision she wasn't going to do that. Because I did not want our boys coming home from school without her being there. And we would just simply do what we needed to do for that to happen. You know, how do we have to live in order for you to be there? Why? Because we only got one stab at parenting. We only got one opportunity. And my best chance of directing Christian and Joel's life was before they got past 7 years of age. The Roman Catholic Church will tell you anytime, you give us a child from birth until they're 6 years of age and we'll have them the rest of their life. Catholic Church understands the principle. You will change the trajectory of a child's life before they ever get in first grade. And I'm telling you, you do not want your child in child care. You want them under you, mama. You do. That's what you need to pray for. And you say, you just don't understand my financial condition? Then take it to the Father. Say, God, when we get ready to have kids, I want to raise them to know you. And that means parenting is going to be a full-time job, or I'll lose them to the world. And so number four, parenting is the greatest influence on a child. The greatest influence on your son or your daughter is parenting. It is bigger than culture. It is bigger than peers. It is bigger than TV. It is bigger in movies. Why? Because you can control all of that. You have the wallet. So I said, I don't know what I'm going to do. My son won't listen to me. Ground him. Ground him. Why? Because you control the wallet. Make him poor. He can't do anything. He's like Job's turkey. He can't get out and go anywhere. Why? Because you won't let him do it. You control those areas. Deuteronomy 6, verse 4. God is restating his law to Israel. This is what he said. He said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. All right, God said, this is how I want you to live. Listen, he said, I want to bless you. I want my hand of favor to be on you. He said, put me first in your life. Worship me. When you put me first, I will be with you. I'll watch over you. I will take care of you. I will assume responsibility for you when you chase after me. And then he says in verse 7, you shall teach these things to your sons and daughters diligently. You talk of them when you sit in your house. You talk of them when you're out in the world. And you talk about them before you lay down at night and when you get up in the morning. You know what he's describing nonstop parenting. That's what he's talking about. He says, bind the law of God as a sign on your hand. In other words, the word of God affects what you do and don't do as a family. Put them as frontlets on your forehead. The word of God controls your thought life. Write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. What does that mean? It means the word of God dominates what takes place in your home and what takes place when you're outside your home. Ladies and gentlemen, the reason so many kids don't connect with the Lord is because they come with mom and dad to church on Sunday, but what happens at the home is 180 degrees from what they hear on Sunday. And when at home doesn't match what they hear from the Word of God, they assume in their minds, okay, we're just kind of playing a game here. This is just kind of what we do. We come here on Sunday. You know, it's kind of the loss of some great time on Sunday, being able to sleep in and all that and everything. But really, that's all it's about. I just kind of show up. This is how I placate the God that's in heaven that I believe in. I just come and I show up for worship. But that doesn't mean it affects my life when I get home. And so when the kids see a disconnect, they're like, okay, then that's how this game is played. It's not really meant to determine how you live your life. You see, Israel, when these things were written in that we just read in Scripture, Israel was immersed in a pagan culture. It was so bad that God told them, when you go into Canaan, you are to kill everybody. That is the only time God ever said that. That is the only time there has truly been a holy war on this planet. The only time. God said, destroy everybody. You know why? The society was so bad, God said, they are not redeemable. He said, I can't even turn them. They are so given to immorality. And the thing was, they were trying to raise their kids immersed in a society that was so ungodly and corrupt. And the story of Israel is a story of how you lose your kids. They raised their children in a corrupt society, and they lost them. Deuteronomy 6, God said, talk to your kids about me. When you get up, when you go to bed, when you're on a trip, talk to them about me. Live for me in front of your children. Pass on your faith to your children. They didn't do it. The next book, Joshua, chapter 2, verse 7. The people served the Lord all the days of Joshua. They were born again. They knew the Lord. And all the days of the elders who survived Joshua, who had seen all the great work of the Lord, which he had done for Israel. Verse 10. And all that generation were gathered to their fathers. All that generation died. And there arose another generation, their kids, after them, who did not know the Lord, nor yet the work which he had done for Israel. Those people saw the hand of God, and they raised a group of kids that never caught their faith. They lost that generation. That's what's happened in America. We lost a generation. And that generation that we lost are university professors and their congressmen and congresswomen and their presidents of the United States of America. We've got a generation in leadership across our nation that doesn't know the Lord. And the truth in your outline, Joshua's generation failed in their parenting. So what do? The sons of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. They served the Baals. They forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. And they followed other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them. And they bowed themselves down to them. And thus they provoked the Lord to anger. So they forsook the Lord and served Baal and Ashtaroth. Now let me tell you something. We had several kids who came to faith according to what was said, who made professions of faith at camp. And we celebrate that. We look forward to some making professions of faith at high school camp and at middle school camp. But here's the deal. I don't know if these kids who made professions of faith, if it was real or not. I don't know. You say, well, how are you going to know? I'm going to know by how they live their life. Do you understand? Ladies and gentlemen, a child is not saved because they prayed a prayer. I'm not saved because I prayed a prayer. Neither are you. It's not like it's a mantra. People say, oh, I know I'm going to heaven. Why? I prayed the prayer. What was that? Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner and I want you to come into my life. What does that mean? It may mean absolutely nothing if there's not a regeneration that takes place. And the only way you know is that when I get up off my knees, my walk is different. Because I am not what I was. When I got down on my knees, I was one way. If I was really saved, when I got up, I was somebody totally different. It doesn't take any time. It's instant. The Holy Spirit comes in. You are not the same. Ladies and gentlemen, do you understand? When somebody comes in church on Sunday morning and says, I'm a believer. I believe the Lord. I'm going to heaven when I die. But on Saturday night, they were drunk, as Mama says, as Cooter Brown in some bar somewhere across town. Do you understand? That is totally antithetical. Those two things do not go together. And we have people teaching the Bible, not here. And on their own church on Sunday morning, teaching the Word of God to people. And on Saturday night, they're bar harping and drinking like a fish. And you ask them, are you going to heaven? Oh, yeah, I'm going to heaven when I die. How do you know that? When God says drunkenness is a sin. Do you know what the first thing happens when you get drunk? You lose all your inhibition. That's why people act like idiots when they get drunk. They start singing when they can't sing. And they start taking off their clothes. Why? Because drunkenness and immorality are always connected. You go to any party that kids throw where beer and alcohol is prolific, what you will find is sex. Why? If you lose your inhibition. And I will preach to the day God brings me home that you don't need alcohol in your life. You don't need it. No, God does not call drinking a sin. But he says everything he says in the Word about alcohol is a warning. It is a warning. And many people are fooled by it. And they get pulled off. And they get pulled into sin. And the mark that I am a believer is I no longer live the way of the world. Doesn't mean I'm perfect, but it means by the grace of God, I am not what I used to be. And I'm simply telling you, if your child sees no difference in your life from your profession, and you still live like you did when you were lost as a ball in tall grass, they will assume that is what it means to be a Christian. And you may have a child that dies and goes to hell just like you. I'm not saying you, but you generally. Everyone did, Judges 21:5, what was right in his own eyes. Isn't that American culture? That's America today. That's the world we live in. That's the world our kids live in. Because our children are being raised in a generation of Americans that are lost. We're in a lost world, a lost country. So here's the thing. Parenting is a blessing. Children are a blessing. Parents, you get to decide what kind of child that you want. And parenting by God's design is the most powerful influence in the life of a child. And it is full time. It is built into God's law at the start. Oh, my word. I've got one more point, and I am out of time. Listen, let me give this to you because I know some of you are not all caught up with this. But parenting, number five, is God's plan for man. Let me just say, here's the truth. Marriage is God's plan. We are sexual creatures. God has put in men the urge for a sexual relationship with a woman. It is there to secure and assure the continuation of the human race. And there is this urge in a man and a woman to come together and to satisfy that desire. God understands that completely. And 1 Corinthians 7 verse 1 says, now concerning the things about which you wrote, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. It just simply means in a sexual way. But God says, I know that that's an impossibility. He gives to some people the ability to live that way. They don't have to get married. That's a gift. Not one that all of us would want. But he gives it. But then he says, but because of immoralities, each man is to have his own wife and each woman is to have her own husband. Why? God says, because you cannot have men and women with sexual desires running around without a spouse. God says, that's not my plan. God says society cannot avoid immorality with perpetual singleness. But let me just lay this bombshell on you. A huge problem, the truth in your outline, a huge problem in America is singleness. Why? Because when you're single, you don't have marriage. And when you don't have marriage, you're not supposed to have kids. But we do. And we have a lot of immorality. We have a society of single people putting off marriage and putting it off and putting it off and putting it off until some undetermined time in the future. But while there is no marrying, there is a plethora of sexual immorality. And so here's the truth. Epidemic singleness is deadly to God's command to marry and to make a family. God says in 1 Corinthians 7, if you don't have self-control, marry. It's better to marry than to burn with passion. Here's the truth in your outline. This is the last one. The most common household in America since 2000 is a person living alone and hooking up. Nearly 50% of all births in America are illegitimate. Now listen, I want you to listen to me. My heart desire this morning was that in all three services, I would have men and women who are living together outside of marriage. Do you know why? Because God wants them here. God wants them here. Because God's desire is to do them good. And there may be a man or a woman this morning and they're thinking, Pastor, you just told me and this girl I love or me and this guy I love that the baby that we made together is illegitimate. I did. But let me give you some good news. And here's the truth. I want you to write it down somewhere in your notes, all right? Here's the truth. Illegitimate is not a life sentence. Illegitimate is not a life sentence. It is a point in time. Jesus Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:17, Jesus Christ makes all things new. Do you know what that means? It means when a man and a woman come before the Lord and they say, Father, you made us, and we want to be blessed by you. And we've just learned from the Word, your Word, we learn from you, not from Pastor John. We learn from you. Your plan for us as your kids is that we would be married. And we've got a baby or two or three. And we don't want them to be looked upon by you as illegitimate. And God says, my plan for you has always been that in my son Jesus, I will wipe away your sin and I will remember it no more. And he said, if you will present yourself before me, if you will make a commitment before me and before your friends and your family that you will live together with this woman, you will live together with this man for the rest of your life until you come home to me, I will bless you and I will wash away your reproach before my eyes and I will look upon you with favor and I will bless your coming out and I will bless your going in, and that child shall be precious unto me and shall no longer be called illegitimate but shall be a son and a daughter that I will bless. Can you say amen to that? Huh? Huh? That's the Father. That's our God. We're going to have the baptism. Philip, I want you to come on out and get in the water if you're not already. And I hope you'll just give me this time. I know I've gone over, but I have such a burden that I've told people again and again, I said, listen, if you will let me, I will marry you. I'll perform this ceremony free of charge. I can tie a knot really good. And I will do it. And I'll not charge you a dime. I'll wear my tux if you want to and won't charge it. I want you to believe. I want you to be blessable. I want God to be able to put his favor on you. And so, if you are here or you're listening and you're not married, I or any of our pastors on staff will do a ceremony for you. We will marry you and we'll sign a marriage license free of charge for you to be able to be blessed by God. And so you think about that. Are you ready, Philip? All right, I want you to do the baptizing, and then I'm going to close this in prayer.
Yeah, absolutely. Right? So it's such a privilege to, just a couple weeks ago, whenever Todd called me up and just told me about Rivers, and it was a blessing to be able to teach him in fourth and fifth grade, and it was really just a time, it's my favorite group, of course, but just proclaiming the gospel over and over. And then I know just one of the things, and just want to encourage you, just praying. And one of the things that I was able to do every Sunday, and I told them that, but just praying for each kid that was on that group and just asking God, you speak, and just asking the Holy Spirit to do what only He can do, which is drawing us to Himself. And so it says in Romans 10:13 that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And the one thing that that means is that's not just a one-time call. It says everyone who calls. To call on the name of the Lord means that your life is going to be a constant calling and depending on Christ as Lord and your Savior. And so, Rivers, have you placed your trust in what Christ has done on the cross and trusted Him for forgiveness, and is He your Lord?
Yes, sir.
All right, so based on that profession, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen. Would you all stand, please? Everyone stand. Our ushers are at the back for us to give our offering to the Lord and our commitments to Him. Of course, all the money that's put in the missions box between the doors is going to our work on the Horn of Africa and the missionaries that we have there. So you give as God touches your heart. Please pray for these series of messages that God will use it. And we'll stabilize families and we'll understand His wisdom more and more as we go from week to week. Father, thank you for today. God, thank you for this incredible privilege. Thank you for this incredible church family that you have assembled and brought together. God, we pray that now you'll grant us wisdom to chase after you, to follow you, to walk alongside those who are learning about you, that we will encourage them in the things of the Lord and in the great heart of the God who is God alone. Lord, we bless you for who you are and for the plans that you have for us that are always good. And now, Lord, lead us to truth. Lead us to the blessings that you have for us and your favor. And we'll thank you now in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. God bless you.